I think the formality which has been assigned to me is to make the principal to welcome the experts who have come here despite their busy schedules. This particular seminar series is being organized under the aegis of our master's department, the Department of Urban Design. And importantly, that we are also celebrating a kind of centenary of our master's program. And it was a very appropriate thing to have some event which are relevant to the society and to the professional. And what is the buzzword going on around in all arenas, those who are following the news related to the economic activity, development activity, and what is happening in context of the profession of architecture and planning. I think the smart cities is the talk of the days these days. Okay. I wonder why such a thing should become a kind of a specially driven initiative by the governments. The cities should have always been smart, believable, and what our facility the citizens require for living a comfortable and happy life, those things should automatically come. But what we see that Indian cities are really in chaos. There's a lot of last 15 days since it is raining heavily in Bangalore, we can see that what kind of chaos exists in the city. The city which we say that it's the Silicon City or the Electronic City or whatever names we give. But if the Bangalore is facing such a situation during monsoon, then we can think of the plight of the other cities in our country. It's a fantastic move on part of the central government to identify a selected town initially. I think the idea was to identify around 190 cities in India and to bring the infrastructure of the cities, the functioning of the cities on par with any international urban center. A lot of money is being pumped into this project. A lot of professionals should be involved in this. And what we find that there are a lot of areas in which I think the consultants are advising the government. That comes to the e-governance for the citizen services, energy management, waste management, urban mobility, water management, and many others. Okay. And already people who see in the business are on the forefront, and they already captured their place. And I think the people who should actually have been on the forefront, like the architects, planners, and urban designers, I think somewhere they have taken the back seat. The movement to me looks like the green building movement, where when this idea was promoted, the people from the air conditioning industry, glass industry, and all those industries, they come forward because they saw some kind of business opportunity in all these projects. And I think the same kind of huge business opportunities are being seen by the other consultants. And I think that our architects and our professional in planning, etc., they don't have such a strong lobby which can lobby with the government and have their say. But of course, we know that until unless the cities are in order, these things will not succeed. So until unless the architects, the planners, the urban designers are given their due place in this urban city, smart city projects, the project is not going to succeed. I think this whole day there will be a number of experts will be speaking about their experiences, their expertise, what they have, and they'll be sharing with you. And I think it's a very fantastic platform we have created today. And we have the young crowd also, the professionals also. I think a lot of brainstorming and the thought-provoking discussions will take place. I will not talk much because I am not experts on Project Smart Cities. The people are here who invited them they will speak. But as the head of the institution, it is my privilege to welcome the keynote speaker, Dr. A. Ravindra. Welcome to RVCA, sir, and welcome to this platform. We have seen the days or the era when Dr. Ravindra was very, very active as a commissioner in Bangalore City, and a lot of work which he has done for the improvement of the Bangalore City. And he's a very appropriate person here to give a keynote speaker. I welcome you, sir, once again, and thanks for being with us. Then we have a lot of other eminent people to speak today. Among the speakers panel, we have Shri R.K. Gautam, Director, Sustainability, Cushman and Wakefield India. I welcome him. Welcome Dr. Gautam. Then we have Shri K. Jaikrishan, CEO of IDEC. I also extend a very hearty welcome to him. Madam Britta Shastri is there, very active urban planner, involved in the development plan of Bangalore City, and she is also a faculty with us. Welcome, architect Brinda. Then we have very, very eminent panelist present here, architect Anup Naik, director of Space Metrics, and also is a, apart from being a hardcore urban designer, he is also a faculty with us. Welcome, architect Anup Naik. Then the first panelist, then we have other set of speakers. Ms. Kathiani Chamraj, Institute Trustee of Civic Bangalore. Welcome, Ms. Kathiani. And then we have, we'll also have Sri S. Vishwanath, Director Rainwater. He has done a lot of work on rainwater harvesting, and we keep reading about his work published in research magazines, local newspapers, and in many forums we will see him speaking on promoting the rainwater harvesting technology. Then we have distinguished panelists also, moderator architect Satyaprakash Varanasi, not new to us. Welcome Satyaprakash. And we also have a panelist, Shri architect Nagaraj Vastare and Srinivas Alvali. So, hearty welcome to you all once again. I'm sure you will have a lot of thought-provoking stuff across the day. I welcome all the participants, the students, and the students from other institutions, the faculty, and the faculty from other institutions also. Thank you very much.
Sir, I now invite Dr. Sanila Wanka, the coordinator for today's event, to present us with the opening remarks.
Good morning. As we begin today's event, I would like to recall noted urbanist Peter Hall's book titled Cities of Tomorrow that he wrote in 1988. In his book, Hall titles his chapters Cities of Imagination, that's for utopian visions of good cities, the city of the dreadful night, and that's for the industrial, post-industrial slum cities, the city in the garden, of course, for the garden cities of Yushin, the city in the region to celebrate the birth of regional planning, the city of monuments for the city beautiful movement, and the city of towers for the cognizant city, and the city of sweat equity for the autonomous city, and so on. So as Hall's titles remind us, a city's built form holds a mirror not only to society, technological capabilities and prevalent power structures, but also to the visions of the city's architects, designers and planners. So that brings us to the central theme of today's seminar. How would a smart city look and engage its residents in urban life? As the title states, this seminar examines the spatial implications of the shift of smart technology from being a driver of the urban economy to a driver of urban policy and form in Bengaluru. The central government of India introduced the Smart Cities Mission in 2015 with the objective to, I quote, promote cities to provide core infrastructure and give a decent quality of life to its citizens, a clean and sustainable environment, and application of smart solutions. The concept draws on the fields of information technology, open data, and infrastructure development, with a focus on building centralized, efficient urban management systems. At the same time, the model also roots itself in local space and society, via concerns for livability, conservation, and participatory governance. So this seminar inquires into the rationale and mechanisms of smart city initiatives in Bengaluru, with the intent to locate the smart in Indian urbanism to start with, and to understand the role of architects and designers and planners in shaping smart Indian cities. As we know, smart city initiatives span the breadth and width of urban life through pan-city projects and area-based proposals respectively. To illustrate, the Bengaluru proposal lists market revitalization, affordable housing, parkland preservation, integrated transport systems, and a pan-city project covering city-centric e-governance services. As an institution steeped in discourses about the built form, we at RVCA consider it our responsibility and privilege to participate in conversations on the topic. In today's dialogue, we engage with questions such as, how do proposed smart city initiatives in Bengaluru respond to existing spatial and social layers of the city? How do they address global-local binaries in the realms of urban identity, knowledge, culture, and space? How do initiatives engage with spaces of public life and governance in the city? And how do the projects under this umbrella of smart city development compare with other urban development projects in scope and implementation? Today, we are very fortunate to have an eminent group of speakers from various disciplines that will share their views on these questions and others. So without further ado, I turn the dais to them with the anticipation of a day of engaging and enriching dialogue. Thank you.
I request our principal, Dr. O.P. Bagme, to kindly present Dr. A. Ravindra with a memento while I introduce him to our audience. Dr. Ravindra joined me. Dr. Ravindra joined the IIS in 1965 and served in various capacities in government, such as Commissioner Commercial Taxes, Managing Director Karnataka Power Corporation, retiring as Chief Secretary to the Government of Karnataka at the end of 2002. He holds a PhD degree in Environmental Studies and has specialized in the urban sector project. He played a pioneering role in promoting civic awareness among citizens through Swabhimana, a platform of resident welfare associations, NGOs, and civic agencies like BBMPA and BDA. He has served on various committees for reforms in housing and urban development sectors at the state and national levels. After retirement, Dr. Ravindra has served as Deputy Chairman, Karnataka State Planning Board, Senior Visiting Fellow at IIM Bangalore, and Advisor to Chief Minister of Karnataka. Dr. Ravindra has published several papers and articles on urban and public policy issues, as well as books. He is currently the Chairman of Smart Cities India Foundation, a not-for-profit organization based in Bangalore. The foundation aims to be a catalyzing force in the process of creating smart and sustainable cities in India. I request Dr. Ravindra to now present the keynote speech. Sir?
And first of all, let me thank the RVCA for inviting me to this smart cities series that this college has undertaken. Well, first of all, let me say that smart cities has been a buzzword in the last couple of years, ever since it was launched in 2015. But it's only later in the second or third list, very recently, that Bangalore has got it. Now, just to give you an idea about urbanization in general, you know, the world population, if you look at the world globally, you know, we are about 7 billion plus now. And you will see that it was in the year 2007, 8 or so that urban population showing an upward slide. So urbanization is gradually increasing, probably rapidly in some cities, and the rural population is coming down or, you know, stabilizing. So, out of the world population of 7 billion, about 3.7 or so would be urban now. And by 2050, it's expected to reach 9 billion. In India itself, you know, India urbanization has not been fast. So there is a misconception that we are urbanizing very rapidly. It's only about 31% of the population according to 2001 census, which is about 377 million, which is urban. And maybe now urban growth is picking up. For the first time, you know, the urban growth has been faster than the rural growth in India. So it's maybe about, I should say, 1/3 of the population is only urban. So 2/3 is still rural. But the impact of urbanization is much higher than rural. Now, if you look at the pattern of urbanization, that means which is very relevant to architects, see, you'll find that most of the population is concentrated in the larger cities. We have what are called 53 million plus cities, more than 1 million. And this number is expected to go to 65 by 2021 and so on. It will probably 670, 80 and all that. Similarly, you know, it's 65% of the population is what is called class 1 cities. That is more than 1 lakh population. But we have large number of smaller towns and, you know, which are not really showing many signs of growth. So now let me come to smart cities. There are different types of cities in this principle mentioned. You know, why do we now call something a smart city? Then we find that every city should become smart. I mean, but you know, smart city is not a word, you know, coined in India by an Indian urbanist. You see, the Westerners, the Western thinkers, you know, have this tendency to go on coming up with new ideas or new phrases for the same thing. Earlier, you know, we called something, we want to develop sustainable city, then eco city, and now then intelligent city. So now, I mean, so this came up quite some years back in the Western countries, is that, you know, city should be smart. I mean, it aims at creating sustainable economic development with high quality of life. There are two parts to it, smart city. One is it has to be economically vibrant. It is not just urban design and beautiful buildings, architecture and all. So you may have all that, but if you don't have economic development, the city will, I mean, gradually die. You know, in China, they have built, I mean, China, they have wonderful infrastructure, cities and all that are extremely good. But there are also cities where there is beautiful infrastructure, but there are no people. Now, they are called ghost cities. You know, they are built for whatever reason. So, on the one hand, you have economic development, on the other hand, you have good quality of life. And one of the basic requirements of a smart city is technology. That is why ICT, information communication technology, is at the root of that. You know, it is the enabler to make a city smart. This is just the features of the smart city, which is, gives you an idea. So it is a holistic concept, unlike many other concepts here. You have all aspects, economic, social, environmental, all the three aspects, you know, are taken into account. So if it comes to buildings, for instance, you know, you speak about smart buildings. You say maybe green building, maybe different types of designs, architecture, but essentially it has to be green. That is, a building should, for instance, you know, consume less energy. I hope you know that in cities, see, it is a building which is the largest consumer of energy. And reducing energy, you know, especially energy and carbon emissions, is one of the key aims of a smart city, smart and sustainable. So similarly, you know, it could environment. And speaking about environment, for instance, you know, nowadays we speak about the loss of open spaces. This is an extremely important aspect, especially in cities like Bangalore. You know, all the things going on about, you know, loss of greenery, loss of public space, etc. So how do you preserve or protect or create new open spaces? Or economy as an economic development, society. Socially, it's also important that, you know, inequalities are reduced. Today, I think one of the biggest problems in developing countries in general, India in particular, is the growing inequality. See, you may call yourself, you know, prosperous country, call India one of the fastest growing economies in the world. We always want to boast ourselves, you know, the rate of growth. 7%, 8%, maybe it's come down slightly, but still, that is only one part. But unless, you know, all people, you know, poverty is eliminated and inequalities are reduced, you cannot call it a smart city. society, utilities, mobility, of course, I mean, we all experience mobility in Bengaluru, the problems. So there also, you know, you use less of private transport. For instance, one of the biggest problems today in Bengaluru or any other large city is the number of vehicles. I mean, in Bengaluru, it's tremendous, it's about 60 lakh vehicles. I mean, it's almost 1:2 is the ratio between human and vehicle population. So how do you control and how do you reduce the use of you know, petrol and diesel driven vehicles, switch to electric vehicles? And yesterday, I found 2 days back, the Union Transport Minister Gadkari made one of the most sensible statements. He has warned the automakers that now the time of producing more and more petrol diesel vehicles is gone, you should switch to electric, I mean, over a period of time. So that's this conflict between promoting the automobile industry on the one hand and in trying to reduce the number of vehicles in cities is one of the problems which probably needs to be solved. Like, you know, as I said, it presents a holistic concept. Smart cities mission, I think you know all of that, but very briefly, there are about 109 cities, and over a period of 5 years, that city is expected to become a smart city. And the selection of cities was done in a competitive process, I'll not go into details. And Bangalore was selected as a smart city in the third round. Now, how is it financed? I mean, this is ultimately come down to funding. How do you fund smart cities? See, each city is expected to get about 1,000 crores over a period of 5 years. And it is shared partly between the central government and the state government. It includes the city government also. Locally also, they are expected to mobilize the government. I think the most important issue concerning smart city or any kind of new project is a question of implementation. Many plans founder because, you know, they are not implemented properly. So here, we have come up with a novel idea. I think for the first time in project implementation in India. Now, they wrote the concept of what is called a special purpose vehicle. So each city selected as smart city, there is a special purpose vehicle set up. And that is not a purely government organization. That is the uniqueness. So it is set up like a company. So it is registered under the